In only a few minutes' time, 28,000 people lie dead, and the wealthiest city in the Caribbean was completely destroyed. And yet, while many tales describing Mount Pelee's infamous 1902 eruption stopped there, the disaster had not ended yet, as there would be a second wealthy town on the island of Martinique which would be completely destroyed in a similar manner to Saint-Pierre by Mount Pelee only 3.5 months later, resulting in an additional 1,380 fatalities. This is the story of Pelee's second largely forgotten deadly Pelean eruption of 1902, which would wipe out the town of Morne Rouge. After all, Pelee would go on to erupt for another 1,246 days after its destructive and deadly day on May 8, 1902. But first, we need to head back to the destroyed town of Saint-Pierre, where, by May 13th, everyone still alive had been rescued and transported away on various ships. Yet, while everyone else had left the disaster area, one man was ordered to go back. And that man was one of the three most famous survivors of the eruption, the burned shoemaker known as Leon Compere Leandre. He was deputized and told to protect what remained of the city and its valuables from unwanted looters. And that is exactly what he did for the first 7 days. During this time span, he observed additional smaller-scale pyroclastic flows and explosions originate from Pelee's summit crater. Yet, something would change on May 20th. To explain exactly what I mean, I want to note that the level of destruction in Saint-Pierre was split into two sectors divided by the so-called annihilation line. Everything north of the so-called annihilation line in the town, that being essentially marked by the Roxelane River, was completely obliterated by the May 8th eruption, with only foundations remaining, marking the most severe damage with zero potential for any survivors. To the south of this line, every structure was still destroyed and the vast, vast majority of their occupants deceased, but many still had walls still standing, indicating negligibly less severe damage. The latter was where the 27 survivors on land were located. Yet, if we look at images of St. Pierre's ruins taken only a few weeks, months, or years later, the entire city would look like it lied within the original annihilation zone. The reason for this is that Pelee would produce a second large explosion on May 20th, which would generate another voluminous and long-traveling pyroclastic flow. This pyroclastic flow was directed further to the south than the May 8th flows, reaching south of the annihilation line. At this point, Leon Compere Leandre was actively running for his life, escaping high onto a hill and just barely outrunning the edge of the pyroclastic flow, even feeling some of its heat. While he had survived a second time, the portion of Saint-Pierre's structure still partially standing south of the Roxelane River did not, being obliterated and then set on fire. As the firestorm spread, the then few remaining walls in the city collapsed, thus completing the destruction of the Caribbean's wealthiest city. With nothing left to protect, Leon Compere Leandre left for good. Yet, across both of these major eruptions in May, the nearby town of Morne Rouge remained intact. Higher on the mountain, it had been protected from prior pyroclastic flows via landslide scarps associated with Pelee's landslide and partial collapse 25,000 years ago. For reference, this is what this 1902 photo before Pelee's eruption described Morne Rouge as. Morne Rouge, the beautiful summer resort of Saint-Pierre's wealthy residents. And that is exactly what Morne Rouge was, which, as of the beginning of 1902, likely had a population of around 1,500 people. Because it had been spared the horrors Saint-Pierre received on May 8th, some people fled to this town, thinking that they might be safe there. And yet, unknown to the local residents, time was running out for this peaceful town. While additional major pyroclastic flows would be observed on May 26th and then June 9th, activity would seemingly decrease into July, although July 9th also saw a large pyroclastic flow occur. Then, from mid-July onwards for a full month, there were zero explosions of any kind that originated from Pelee's summit, with only minor intermittent ash emissions occurring. This lull would not last, and around August 15th, eruptive activity increased once again. That marked when it appears that a new batch of magma ascended into the volcano's shallow subsurface, resulting in new explosions that created larger ash plumes, more frequent pyroclastic flows, and sent tumbling blocks of Pelee's andesite lava dome down its southwest slopes. A pyroclastic flow containing pumice then swept down River Blanche from one of these partial lava dome collapses, reaching the ocean and creating a Blanken ash flow deposit. Powerful Volcanian eruptions followed the next week, and there were increasing indications that Pelee's growing summit lava dome as a whole was becoming unstable. From August 28th onwards, continuous rumbling coming from the volcano was heard, indicating the building pressure underneath said andesite lava dome, which was soon going to be catastrophically released. This release eventually happened on August 30th and occurred at one of the worst times possible, during the night when the incoming pyroclastic flows and its speed will be difficult to observe. This occurred at 8:45 p.m. local time, more than 2 hours after the sun had set and a full hour after any traces of light had vanished from the sky. As a growing crack in Pelee's lava dome rapidly burst open, a cloud of hot moving incandescent material marking a large pyroclastic flow descended largely to the southwest. Yet, a portion of the rising eruption column would soon collapse back to the ground, this time largely to the south-southeast, causing it to descend towards a new area previously spared from devastation. This pyroclastic flow then expanded to cover other sectors of the volcano, including the south, north, and west-northwest, advancing at a speed of around 55 miles per hour or 88.5 kilometers per hour. It only took 40.7 seconds for this wall of death to travel a full kilometer. This pyroclastic density current seemingly was less dense than its earlier counterparts and as a result was able to climb some regional hills, soon spilling over and slamming the outskirts of Morne Rouge 131 seconds in. As hot gas particles and fragments of several hundred degrees Celsius rock impacted buildings, people suffocated and were severely burned, with many quickly perishing. As this current advanced, it didn't completely demolish all structures, but rather left many still standing, albeit with significant damage. 36 seconds later, the still advancing pyroclastic flow impacted the outskirts of the town of Ajupa Bullion, quickly causing additional casualties. By the time the center of Morne Rouge was hit, already 1,000 people were dead or dying from this day. The advancing pyroclastic flow eventually lost its momentum and then lifted, first to the north and east and then to the south. Even Saint-Pierre was struck, leaving behind this 13-centimeter or 5.1-inch thick deposit. In only a little under 6 minutes, an area of 109.53 square kilometers or 42.29 square miles had been struck and burned by pyroclastic flows, and a total of 1,380 people now lie dead. These would be the last fatalities Mount Pelee's eruption would produce, bringing the total overall dead up to 29,803, comprising 15% of Martinique's entire population at the time. Afterwards, Pelee's eruption transitioned to a less explosive one as its summit lava dome continued to expand. Then, something unusual began to grow during November. A large, nearly vertical pillar of gray rock began jutting out upwards of the top of the andesite lava dome. This marked what is known as a lava spine. Lava spines form when viscous lava, typically at least of a basaltic andesite composition or more silica-rich, are squeezed upwards and then further squeezed and narrowed by the sheer mass of material and overburden in the lava dome into a narrow, jagged vertical pillar. At Pelee, the volcanic spine grew over the next 6.5 months at about the same rate, eventually reaching a width of 140 meters or 459 feet, and a stunning height of 350 meters or 1,148 feet. This means that Pelee's spine was taller than the tallest building in the world at that point, having the modern-day equivalent height of an 82-story skyscraper. To understand just how large this is, here is how Pelee's summit would appear from Saint-Pierre if it was to exist on top of its modern edifice today. Sadly, what was the tallest lava spine known to have formed in the world in historical times started to collapse, first slowly and then rapidly due to being unable to hold up the massive overlying rock. Thus, by late July 1903, the lava spine had completely collapsed and would not reappear. Eruptive activity as the subsequent months and then years progressed continued to decrease, although small-scale collapses of the growing lava dome continued to generate occasional pyroclastic flows. This lava dome would eventually grow to a volume of more than 100 million cubic meters, eventually ceasing its eruption on October 5, 1905. Another explosive eruption would follow from 1929 to 1932, but would be at least a full order of magnitude less explosive. That VEI-3 eruption was more explosive than the volcano's 18th and 19th century eruptions, and would go on to generate both pyroclastic flows that would occasionally reach the coastline and a second lava dome overlaying and just on top of the 1902 to 1905 lava dome. Mount Pelee has not erupted since. So, what did the world learn from Pelee's two early 20th century eruptions? The most important aspect was volcanology, and the world learned about the concept and hazards associated with pyroclastic flows. Pelee's two eruptions and eruptions of the Kilauea volcano in Hawaii were actually the reason why modern volcanology developed. Stay tuned for the final episode on Pelee, which will discuss why the volcano's alert level is currently not green, but instead yellow. As a final note, I would like to thank my new YouTube channel member, Everything Is Coming Up Rosie, for supporting my work. Support like this via Patreon and YouTube members allows me to make these longer form videos.